Hey guys, Drifter here. Welcome to Modern Warfare in Depth. In today's episode, I wanted to take a look at pro classes because here on this channel and on Exclusive Aces channel as well, we recommend weapons like the AUG and the FAL and M4, whereas pro gamers are much more prone to something like the Grau, MP7, and MP5. So what I wanted to do today is take a closer look at those and then compare them to casual classes. And before we get in too much more, I wanted to let you know that the needs of a competitive gamer are very different than that of most of us. Thanks to skill-based matchmaking, every lobby they play in will be very competitive and filled with sweats. Most of the gameplay here was me playing with pros, and I will let you know that the lobbies were noticeably harder when I was playing with these guys. There were very few easy enemies to take down. And pros have incredible talent when it comes to aiming and decision making, and because of that, they value predictability above almost everything else. But first, before we get into the stats today, I wanted to let you know that today's video is sponsored by Raid Shadow Legends, because I'm still playing it. Just take a look at my daily logins reward page to see how far into this game I've gone. I'm pushing 6 months here. Raid Shadow Legends is a dark fantasy turn-based RPG game, so no cutesy anime girls here. I like to play the game during my daily exercises because since it's turn-based, I can play a turn or two between sets, and it's nice that it's cross-play between mobile and PC. There have been 25 million downloads so far. It has 1 million concurrent players every day, which is honestly more than most COD games even in their cycle, and has over 216,000 clans created, including the one I'm in, Prestige Legends, with me and Prestigious Key. Right now, I'm gearing up to go on a big PvP streak because I've mostly done PvE so far. The game is pretty complex and I've needed some help, so it's been really neat to see a whole group of like Twitch streamers and YouTubers and just the whole community grow up around this game, including alternate versions of me that do in-depths on various topics that have helped me learn how to get better and how to build a better team. So that's really neat to see that it's going on out there. I have a ways to go before I'm a PvP god though. I need to get some better artifacts and some more level 60 units, but you guys can get a head start if you use the link down there below in the description. If you click there, new players will get 200,000 silver for free and one free champion, which is Treefeller. Honestly, a lot better than quite a few of the champions that I have so far. So what are you waiting for? Click the special link down there below, download Raid Shadow Legends, and join me. Rewards are available for the next 30 days only. And the ad segment is over. We are back to in-depth proper now. Before I move into the stats, and or comparative stats primarily is what we're doing today, I wanted to show you the actual classes that we're going to be showing gameplay of so you can kind of see how they're built and what they're supposed to do. First up today, I wanted to take a look at the Grau. This is sort of a standard competitive Grau class. A lot of people like the 26-inch Archangel barrel, which we'll be talking a lot about, and it's preferred over the Nexus or Season, even though those are statistically superior in a lot of ways. Monolithic suppressors, common, big mags. I personally run the XRK Void Grip instead of No Stock. I do believe that No Stock is more common amongst competitive gamers, but I dislike what it does to my recoil. But you could trade either one of those out, and it would still be the competitive Grau class. Don't forget the Commando foregrip. For the MP5, we run 45 round mags instead of the 10mm rounds because the 10mm rounds don't boost damage or time to kill. It's better to just have more ammo. The Commando foregrip is a godsend for tightening up your recoil. I personally like stippled grip tape, though that could be substituted for the 5mW laser, and the collapsible stock, though the close quarters combat stock is also acceptable for this kind of build. And I do run the subsonic integral suppressor because you get a lot of benefits out of one attachment, though I will admit the monolithic is more common. And moving along today, I wanted to take a look at the classes themselves. EOD is going to be the most common one, so RPG and C4 spam is less painful. Amped, also extremely common, so you can swap weapons back and forth, which is a godsend if you have a sniper on your class. For the MP7, 60-round mags are the most common, along with a monolithic suppressor to increase range. No stock is the most common because people value the very fast aim-down-sight speed and the movement speed, which offsets your bigger mag, though personally I like the close quarters one a little bit better, but I ran no stock for most of this video. And for the underbarrel attachment, you're kind of choosing between Commando or Ranger foregrip. In this case, I chose Ranger because I'm already losing recoil control with the no stock. And you could definitely trade out stippled grip tape for 5mW laser. A lot of people go back and forth on these, but I'm running stippled because I hate being seen. Those are some pretty good baseline pro player classes. That's not going to be every class that they run, and it's not going to be every player running the same thing, but that's pretty close. You'll find some variation depending on personal taste. Now let's talk about some comparative stats. The Grau, M4, Kilo, and Ram 7 all deal the exact same amount of damage per shot, at least up close. And what that means is that the M4 and Ram 7, especially the Ram 7 since they shoot faster than the Grau, have a faster time to kill. So you would probably ask yourself, well, why would any competitive gamer choose a weapon like the Grau when the Ram 7 and M4 clearly have a time to kill advantage, especially in close quarters combat? And the answer is that the Grau has much better damage over medium to long range. Just the damage profile on this gun is much more forgiving at long ranges, and depending on your attachment setup, you could actually have 25 to 30% more range than the M4, which is just downright fantastic in my opinion, especially in Warzone. In base multiplayer, it might not matter too much, but when you're shooting at people at very long ranges in Warzone, that 25 to 30% range adds up very, very fast. The Grau also has a very predictable recoil pattern. When you put the Archangel barrel on, which we're going to be talking about in just a second, it is extremely predictable and extremely easy to use, much more so than almost anything you can put on the M4, which leads to pro players valuing that as well. This is the base Grau iron sights. They're not bad, but they're not anything special. However, when you put the Archangel barrel on there, look how clear that is. Look how open those sights are. Look how precise the four sights are. You're almost like, it's almost like having a red dot sight compared to something like the M4, which in my opinion is quite bulky, or compared to the Ram 7, which while not terrible per se, is still a little bit on the bulkier side and more difficult to use, especially given that these weapons have more recoil. I also wanted to show you how clear it looks when you're shooting down the Archangel iron sights and compare it to the base recoil of the weapon. So on the left, that is just the base plain Jane Grau, and on the right is the Battle Royale one, and it looks like that kicks up more, but do keep in mind that I had 20 more bullets in the magazine, so it's actually much more compressed and much more accurate and easy to shoot. Statistically speaking, the Grau only lags behind the M4 and Ram 7 by only a little bit in close quarters. It isn't that crazy slow, it's not going to be noticeably worse, and you won't have very many gunfights in a Battle Royale game that's truly you seeing each other at the same time and the faster time to kill gun wins, but it performs much better at long ranges. So pro players are going to prefer this overall improvement at long ranges with the negligible losses up close, and since the weapon has fantastic iron sights, this will allow you to spend your attachment points more efficiently on other things like bigger mags or the Commando foregrip or no stock or something like that, so that you can just put more things on your weapon, which is better in Battle Royale. And one pro tip about the Grau, if you're going to run this class, I just wanted to let you guys know the recoil is so tight that especially when mounted, you can occasionally challenge snipers with this and other DMR users. You would be absolutely shocked at the range at which you can get solid hits on people with the Grau, and I think that is really the reason that pros use it more than anything else, of even if they don't have any other gun, you can still actually challenge a sniper with it. Let's talk about submachine guns now. I personally have been a fan of the AUG 556 for a very long time. I've advocated it endlessly on this channel, and I still think it's a fantastic weapon, but the recent nerf to the weapon makes it kill slightly slower in close quarters combat than the MP5, because now the AUG takes one more shot to kill, so the MP5 does hedge an advantage here in true up-close face-to-face combat. I do want to say that the AUG has much better performance at long ranges, medium ranges, in terms of damage, shots to kill, and just the bullet drop, because the MP7, MP5 will be doing 9mm and this one will be doing 5.56. But the base MP5 greatly outperforms the base AUG. The AUG SMG requires a lot of attachments to be good. The most important one is right off the rip, you have to put the 5.56 ammo conversion on it to boost the damage and even make it remotely competitive time to kill with other weapons. If you don't have the 5.56 ammo, it's just a subpar weapon, but that one attachment elevates it greatly, but now you've got a gun that, okay, so I only have four attachments on. The next bad thing is I wanted to compare the iron sights on the MP5, which are clear, clean, and easy to use, to the obstructive, bulky, and honestly kind of difficult ones on the AUG. There is a clear difference in quality of iron sights on these two weapons, and you won't find very many players, competitive or not, skipping optical attachments on the AUG in favor of anything else. The AUG requires 5.56 and a red dot sight to be competitive, whereas the MP5 requires pretty much nothing. I do want to show you a comparison in recoil patterns too. This is the base AUG 5.56 with no attachments. It kicks up pretty high, that's pretty noticeable. Whereas the MP5 is a lot more contained. It's a little bit more wobbly side to side, but you can see that's going to be much, much easier to control than the AUG 5.56. And this is with no attachments. With several attachments, it can be even tighter. Keep in mind that with the AUG, you're actually going to lose recoil control, which is your vertical recoil, if you choose to put the 60 round mags on it. So when you get the big mags, it's going to kick even more and be even worse. Whereas the MP5 with extended mags doesn't have that problem. And even a minimum recoil AUG class with the longest barrel and the compensator and the grips and all that stuff isn't much better than the base MP5, at least up close. You know, for those kind of ranges, it's not very different. The MP7 has a very similar story too, however I do want to point out that the MP7 may kill enemies a bit slower, but it has a massive starting mag and very predictable recoil. So the MP7 actually kills slower than the AUG, and it kills slower than the MP5, but you've got 40 rounds just to start with before you boost it, and it has the most predictable recoil of almost any weapon in the game. And one intangible benefit is that it fires really fast, and this tends to make it more forgiving, and it also tends to startle enemies. Getting hit by one or two big bullets for whatever reason isn't as jarring, shaking, or scary as just getting hammered by a whole bunch of little ones really fast. You kind of feel like you're getting lasered, you feel like you're getting blown up faster, and it makes the enemies panic and do dumber things. Of all pro classes, one thing that you're going to see in common across almost all of them is the Commando foregrip. The Commando foregrip is awesome because it reduces your horizontal recoil, which is by far the hardest to control. Most pro players are okay with high vertical recoil as long as it's not going side to side too much, because to compensate, you only have to pull down. I think even in like CDL matches and sweaty lobbies and competitive gamers, most players are going to gravitate toward the Commando foregrip over almost anything else. I wanted to do a comparison of the recoil of a base MP5 versus one that has a Commando foregrip on it, because this weapon has a lot of horizontal recoil. Taking a look at it, the one on the left is base, the one on the right has the Commando foregrip. The vertical is about the same, but if you take a look, the first three shots with the Commando foregrip are almost perfectly vertical, which makes them easy to control, and the overall recoil pattern has very little horizontal wobble to it, which means you only have to pull down to compensate and just makes it a very, very easy weapon to use. We've done a lot of comparative stats today and a lot less in hard numbers, but the point that I want to drive home is that at the end of the day, competitive gamers are willing to make sacrifices in time to kill as long as their classes can maintain a high degree of predictable recoil and easy to use iron sights. If your recoil is predictable, that's probably going to get you more kills in the long run than just having super high time to kill, because you can land your shots consistently. And having good iron sights means that you don't have to waste an attachment on optics. You can spend that attachment on bigger mags, something to ADS faster, sleight of hand, just almost a laser, almost anything, since you just don't need it. It's like getting a pure bonus. So there's a lot of efficiency in having good iron sights. I think that what I'm going to do for the next couple episodes of In-Depth is try to dive really deep into these weapons, because today's episode was like an overview. It was like a general comparison, but I think that there's a lot of max minning that can be done around the MP5, MP7, and Grau, and I'd like to really dive deep and test them out and see if I can find a truly optimal build sometime in the future. Guys, I hope you enjoyed this episode of In-Depth. I hope that you learned something useful. If you did, don't forget to like, favorite, and subscribe. Drifter out. At the very end of the video, I just wanted to show you a nice clutch that I got with the MP7, where I pushed dangerously far into the gas to loop back around and win the match. No commentary or anything here, just some good gameplay showing you how good the MP7 can be in Warzone.
Target ID.
5 remaining.
Marked it off.
Gas is
closing in. Relocating the safe zone. Last chance, soldier. Kill or be killed. He took what was yours and made them pay for it.